So yes, my name is Joakim Sundén, and I originally come from Buda in the north of Sweden, very far away from this hot and exotic place. But as Dimitri said, I now live in Stockholm, Sweden. I used to work as a consultant, and the last couple of years I've been using lean and agile concepts to coach individuals and teams and organizations. But now I work at Spotify, and that's an online music service offering users the ability to stream more than 16 million tracks on demand using our unique technology. I don't know if you've heard about it. Do you like music? So if you like it, I'd be happy to show it to you later. I don't know when you will launch it in Latvia. And I'm invited here today to run the Red Bead Experiment. And I was told that I could have an hour, so it won't be much of a break in getting to the next session, I'm afraid. But we will be able to cover everything at least. So the world famous consultant, Dr. W Edwards Deming, he is said to be the man who taught the Japanese, America, and many other countries about quality. He created the Red Bead Experiment in 1982 to communicate his take on management. And David P. Joyce is a brittle key awardee, someone who has made outstanding achievements and leadership within the lean Kanban community. He has adapted this experiment for IT. So I'm using his adaptation. Okay, so the white bead company in this experiment, it's a company that make white beads, you know, reeds, like pearls. And we're a high quality company. We listen to our people. We're ISO certified, CMMI level 5. We use ITIL, of course. And we recently gone agile too. So that's why I, who am the manager, is wearing jeans and a t-shirt panel. That's the biggest difference so far. And now we are recruiting. So I need 3 willing workers. You must be willing to put in the best effort. Continuation of job is based on performance. No experience in making beads necessary. Educational requirements, nil. So can I have 3 volunteers? Yes, please, sir. You. And anyone else? We have a 3rd volunteer. Yes, please, sir. Great. And now I need an inspector, a junior inspector. Must be able to distinguish red from white, and must be able to count to 20. No other experience necessary. Any volunteers? Junior inspector? Oh, now the requirements were a little bit... No one can distinguish red from white? Please. Thank you. Okay, now the most difficult position, the one of the chief inspector. Same qualifications as inspector, but must also be able to speak in a loud voice. Yes! Last but not least, we have a position that's not advertised as a recorder, who needs to record the effort of the workers. You have to be able to type letters and numbers into an Excel sheet. Should be plenty of...
Who is able to write?
Yes.
Is anyone able?
You can't let me come home to Sweden and say, no one in Latvia could write. Yes, please. Thank you. Awesome. So, yeah, inspectors, you can't stand over here. No collusion between workers. You're supposed to inspect these guys. You can't stand over here. I thought there was a note book here. Someone has a paper for writing notes?
Actually, on the second, paper.
Great. I pull out a pen.
There was a pen as well.
A recorder.
Oh, I was.
I should have one.
Special stuff. I don't. I don't need it. Okay, so the junior inspector, that's you. You hold that?
I need to write as well.
Yes, you need to write. Oh, sorry, that wasn't clear.
Okay.
Okay, so let's see. Union Inspector, you now have your pen and paper. And the recorder, you will update the spreadsheet I will show you in a short while. And those of you in the audience, you can observe, and later we will discuss the experiment. So it may look like the inspection department is overstaffed, maybe, 3 workers and 2 inspectors. But inspection is a vital and difficult task. How else can we protect our customer and judge our workers? And it's even trickier than you might think. And just to show you how tricky it is, we're going to do a test. So I want you to count the number of F's in this text. You have 20 seconds. How many F's, like in Frederick or France? Quiet, count. So, and now at the same time, in chorus, when I count to 3, you say the number out loud. 1, 2, 3.
Yeah.
Not as easy as you might think, so that's why I needed people who can count.
The actual answer is 6.
It's easier if you count them backwards, actually. About 20% get this right, so don't be disappointed if you do. So, let's start. Now, I don't know if you have to rearrange for the camera. You're supposed to be standing here. Can we get them in the camera? Anyone with the camera? Are they in? Do we have to move stuff around? Or are we good?
Okay.
We're good. Okay. Sorry, I'm destroying the illusion of TV. Okay, thank you. The recorder, please. Okay, so now I'm going to explain the job to your workers, but first I want you to line up in increasing scale. Who of you are average?
Skills.
Yep. Average skills.
I don't have any skills.
Come on, who is average? And stand in the order of.
Okay, operation. I'm a tester.
Okay. So, great. And can you please state your name for the recorder and give it up to me? So, thank you. Okay, pay close attention now while I explain the job. We have been given an order, like this. Yes, we've been given an order by the customer to make white beads. And I need you all to do your best every day, give me 100%. So material come in form of red beads and white beads. And the job is to make white beads. Okay? Not red beads. The customer won't pay for red beads. Is that clear? White beads, okay. And we have a strict and rigid procedure that's defined to avoid errors. And as you saw, we're CMMI certified and stuff like that. So clearly, with such a well-defined procedure, any variation or anything going wrong is totally up to you, the workers. So please pay attention when I explain the job. Oh, but I also want to say about the process that we have delivered successfully in the history. We have a history of delivering a lot of successful projects, so the procedure is tried and tested. Just to make sure you understand that. And the work standard is 50 items of production. And we have this paddle with a hose that will pick up the beads. And it's 5 by 10, so 50 holes. You understand? And each worker takes turn and draw a sample from the box with 50 beads, 50 white beads. And before we do that, you have to mix the material. So it's a very complex procedure. So I'll show you, look carefully. So, the material is now mixed. Did you get that? Yes? Okay. So, now you will each produce 50 beads. And you take the paddle, like this, firm in your hand. You put it 8 centimeters above, exactly. And 44 degrees. No, talking back. So 44 degrees, and gently but firmly push the paddle into the beads. You won't have to hold a microphone really while doing it. And now you raise, it's covered in beads, you see? And now you raise it to the 44 degree angle, sorry, and retain the angle and draw out the beads. If there are some surplus beads, you shake them off gently. My technique doesn't get surplus beads. So. And careful to not drop these on the floor, because the material is very expensive. And this is white beads. I deliberately added a few red beads, so you can see what not to produce. As you can see, it's about 5 red beads. And since this is, yeah, it's exactly 5 beads. Good counting. Could be an inspector one day. Okay, and once the sample is drawn, it's ready for inspection, you carry it over to the junior inspector. And you count them in silence, and the chief inspector, you count them at the same time. You remember how difficult it was to count? Yes. And you write down the number. If you think it's correct, you say it loud.
Correct.
No, the number. Sorry. Quiet. And then
Dismissed.
Yes, and then you go back with the paddle and carefully empty the beads. Okay? Then the next worker mixes and draws a new sample. Can you hear me? I feel like I'm not.
Yes.
Yes. Okay, so are you ready?
Yes.
Do you follow me? Understand the procedure?
Sure.
Okay, so then we can start. Oh, wait. 8 centimeters above.
8 centimeters.
Yeah. Okay. So, just because this is your first round on your training, so
I can allow for five red beads.
No more than that, because it's your first one.
Ten dismissed.
Ten. What happened? Is it
most of the first time?
You know, the customers are paying for white beads. Yeah. I was able to, right?
What is the same procedure about emptying?
Empty, you must empty that. Okay. Careful not to spill the material.
Sure.
And your jobs depend on your performance here. Easy? Okay. Oh, sorry, you didn't put the names on the...
There's two different sheets.
Oh, there's two different sheets. Sorry.
10. Dismissed.
10? I didn't ask you to do the same thing he did. The same thing I did. No more than 5 red beads. 5. But you understand, our best worker. There's a lot of competition for your jobs. Okay, I'll go. No gymnastics. Don't upset the beads.
Seven. Dismissed.
7? You said 5, but, well, clearly you're better than the other two. You're just average, so what's the big spectrum? So, okay, I don't know, was it something that you didn't understand from the procedure?
We need to improve the procedure.
And the procedure is tested, and we've delivered lots of successful projects in the past, so Please, don't question. No talking back. Don't question the problem. So, okay. This is clearly not good. Let's see at what we record. Okay, we have 27. Our job is to deliver 600 beads, white beads, to the customer.
And shall we count white or red?
This is the defects, the red ones. So let's use a burn down. That's what we do now when we're agile. Okay. So for the first one, we're supposed to do 3 workers, 50 beads each. We should land around 450, but unfortunately we have 27 defects, so gets us somewhere there. Okay. Still possible to do progress, I guess. Since this was your first iteration, I understand that you were new to the process and so on. But from now on, I expect you to do no more than 5 red beads. And preferably not at all. Okay? Try your best.
We will try.
Think about your family. Okay. Come on.
No need to be all day long.
44 degrees. 44 degrees, put out. Inspector.
Seven, dismissed.
Uh-oh. Seven, okay. Well, clearly you've learned the job, you're doing an improvement, but I think there's still some misunderstanding as to what the job is about.
Maybe the salary increase will help.
No talking back. Yes, well, seven. Okay. It's an improvement, at least. I'll give you that. Good, please.
Eight. Dismissed.
Eight. So, white beads, not red beads.
How about
the process? Okay, it's an improvement, please. Not upset beads, please. No shaking. Okay. Our best worker. Now, punches are gold. You should be more like Kuno.
Nine, dismissed.
Nine? What's happening? You're not improving. I know what's going on here. You became complacent about doing so well the first iteration, and now you think you can just kick back. So this is I don't know if I clearly communicated this, but the process works. We've delivered a lot of successful projects in the past, and you just follow the process, everything will sort itself out. Okay, so can we please add up the numbers? So we should be around 300 now, but
minus 51.
Well, 51. So we are 351, right? Somewhere there. Okay, so revenue is not coming in as expected, costs are overrun. What should we do? What should we do? Look at those numbers. Are you proud of yourself?
Sure, please. See the motivational posters I put up for you. That inspire you to take pride in your work and do a good result.
Okay? So, you've been around 7. You can do it again. Okay? Now, for the third iteration, we will do an appraisal at the end of the iteration to see how your performance has been. And on top of that, I will also add an incentive. If you can do 2 defects or less, I will give you a bonus. 5 Latvian money. Okay. 1 is acceptable, 0 as well. But 2 or less, you'll get the bonus. And just to show you how good a manager I am, if the whole team does 6 or less together, there's pizza and beer.
Right?
Okay.
Okay, so remember your appraisals coming up, and you have a great incentive to do your best. So, that's all the instructions.
The money.
You had the training, yeah. Look at the money. See the motivational posters.
No.
A good feeling about this.
Five. Dismissed.
Five. Well, that's good. That's definitely an improvement. I'm glad the incentive worked, but... forget about the bonus, the money. You could have done two or less, and you would have received the money.
Not this time.
No need to be all day about it, please.
Damn it. Six. Dismissed.
Six? That's not even close to two. Well, it's an improvement. Okay. Remember, white seats, no red. Remember the money, the beer, and the pizza? It's been hard with the beer and the pizza, of course. But...
Seven. Dismissed.
I don't know what to say. I give you a clear incentive. I give you a bonus. I give you pizza and beer. Did you forget about that? Did you all forget about the bonus? Were you nervous about your upcoming appraisals?
The shame already.
Okay, so let's do some appraisals. Can you see? Dmitry. Okay, you started out at 10. That was really lousy. Then you did improve. You learned on the job. And with the right incentives in place, I'm glad that you really improved and you've shown that it's possible, clearly possible, to do what I've been saying all along. Okay, if you continue to improve in this way, then who knows? The sky's the limit. Okay, Andre, that's correct pronunciation. What are you doing over there? You're standing in the wrong room. okay. So you also had the lousy start with 10, then you improved and you learned the process, and of course the incentives worked like we figured they would do, but not enough.
But there is steady improvement.
So, yeah, but you have to improve more.
Sure.
Think about your family. And Gunnar, our best worker, who showed the others how to do it, but then you became complacent and got a high number again, but with the incentives in place, at least you improve. But you have to do much more, much better if you don't want to get fired, basically. Okay. No quitting. So let's sum up the results here. We should be at 150, right? Plus 5169 is 219. Oh, it's not looking good. What can we do? So, I've been talking to the customer, and it doesn't look good. Management have been watching the numbers. And I'm informed that unless we show a substantial improvement, they are going to cancel the project. But I came through with a fantastic suggestion that might save the project, actually. Instead of closing it down, we're going to keep our two best workers, and we have to let the worst one go. Those with a real can-do attitude can stay on, and we will deliver. We can't afford to make so many defective products. So, as you can see, that's good. The recorder knows what he's doing. So, Dmitry, I'm sorry, but unfortunately, we have to let you go. You did your best. You can pick your pay up on the way.
I'm the best.
Thank
you. I'm the best.
You're confusing me with your moving about procedure state. Thank you. You did your best, but it wasn't good. Okay, great. No, nothing is stopping us. The two best workers. I'm proud to have you on board for this wrapping up this project. Okay, so the best one, Dmitry, you will do two shifts. You have to keep up
the salary.
And there is no doubt that this will work. Yes, you will get salary. So, no. Okay. Okay. 44 degrees. Okay.
No. Nine dismissed.
Nine.
Sorry.
I'm sure.
Yes.
So what's happening here? It's some kind of
I think the pressure is
they're dragging you down to their level of production. Okay, so that's Luna.
His second shift.
Oh no, yeah, that would be in the end. Okay. Come on. Your job depends on this.
Six dismissed.
Six. That's not good enough. That's not good enough. But it's an improvement.
It's an improvement.
Okay. One final effort to save the project. Come on, you're a best worker. Excellent technique.
No.
That's okay.
Eight dismissed.
Eight. Okay. So, because of your failure to understand the process and to understand that it's white beads, we will not be able to finish on time. Let me see. How much? 5169, 92, right? So, there was nothing wrong with my idea, clearly, to keep the best workers. They did better than Andre's lousy 10. But unfortunately, you didn't have the stamina to pull off two shifts. And you got some kind of somehow complacent over your efforts. Good result earlier. So I'm sorry, but management have decided that we have to close the project. And you can pick up your pay. You did your best. This will go on your record. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Behavior in the workplace. Thank you, thank you. Okay. So.
No need to record.
Oh, yeah, I don't need. Yes, thank you for your work. Please have your salary. And you too, sir, thank you. Susie, unfortunately, I only had five, but I give it to you. I don't want you to leave here without you. Okay, so what happened here? What happened? Apparently, incentives worked very well. They were doing lousy, and at least they improved, and they had some motivation and some incentives in front of them. Right? Dmitry clearly showed that... Did I step on something?
Just move.
Oh, sorry. Yes, and Dmitry showed that five is possible, so there was nothing wrong with the process. But what do you think happened? Why didn't they do better? How can you explain this?
Their expectations were set too high.
Sorry, who said that? my expectations. This is a tried and tested procedure. We've delivered projects like this in the past without a problem.
Not with this team.
Oh yeah, the workers didn't do a good job. But they had the training. They had the same training as everyone else. So anyone else has an idea why this didn't work?
Training was not good enough.
There was nothing wrong with the training. I mean, Dmitry could if he wanted to. The incentives came too late. Yeah, that's actually the conclusion I have to go. Does anyone have another idea? Or can we conclude that this was
the manager has to be fired.
The manager? I clearly showed my high importance for the project. With the motivation, the incentives, things got better. If they had been left on their own accord, nothing would have improved.
You failed the project.
Sorry?
You failed the project.
I failed. Oh no, the workers failed. I gave them everything. Support, motivation, incentives. But the workers didn't want to do it.
Well, it's the pressure, so you're responsible for it.
Oh no, I can't be responsible for such a lousy effort.
Never put red bees into the whites.
Sorry?
Never put the red bees into the whites.
Yeah, but that's the way the material comes.
Yeah, the problem with the supplier, they gave us faulty goods, you know. It's not kind of our fault.
Excuses, excuses. But oh, why do you think? Why do you think we saw this problem?
The iteration was too big. They don't need to put so much effort. Like that, they put this thing too much inside. They could put less, and then the red meat would be less.
Okay, you think if we have a smaller paddle, there would have been fewer defects?
Or maybe a bigger one.
A bigger one.
Perhaps he was referring to the amount of the resources given as materials. Too much materials at the same time.
Okay, yeah, but that's the work. That's how it is. How can we explain these numbers?
They are irrelevant.
It's don't count the bugs, count the product made. So they could do more iterations at the same time.
But it's still it's irrelevant, absolutely.
Who's saying that? Who's saying that?
I'm saying that.
Why is it irrelevant?
Because we just saw that.
It's not like it's random or something. If it was random, then how can you explain this? It's not its word,
right? If you try to explain any numbers, you can use any kinds of words or anything, and you can...
Numbers does not show anything.
Yeah.
Okay, there's some truth in that. So I was just role playing, just to, you know. I will explain a little bit more about my thinking. But what can we learn from this? Can I hear from someone of the workers? How did you feel? How did it feel to you? Did you feel responsible for the result? Or?
No. We tried
to do our best, but we cannot affect the work.
Yeah, we did not have a chance to affect it. If we would have a word and we could speak and tell that actually we see some places for the improvement, like for example, could you handle us the glass and give us one day off and we'll fix the problem.
Yeah, but I know, I mean, the process worked in the past, so. You? Yeah, when I did this experiment for the first time, I was one of the workers, and I really felt like I really wanted to do good.
We did want to do good.
Oh, not red beads, no red beads. And yet I know that I have no way of influencing them. So, did incentives work?
No. Not really. Of course they did.
So, the numbers.
I have a question. You said at most 5 defects, and there are 12 rats, but you have burned down going from 600, not.
Yeah, because I allowed for 5 defects. Or
so, 600 is not obtainable. It should be like you have no defects and you have 600.
Yeah, exactly. That was the goal. I allowed for a few in the beginning, but just because they were new. But then we would have been close to deliver. But that's right. We should probably have said 585. So incentives didn't work. Okay, did the motivational posters help at least?
These posters are not in the right place.
Yeah, actually,
because
the
one we saw them
was better than the
on that
ones.
Wall.
Yeah.
The
one
that were behind us.
They were on the right. That's good thing. Yeah, I should put them on another wall. So, how did you feel about the incentives and the motivational posters? It wasn't helpful, okay? Anything else?
It was kind of
irritating because we couldn't see a way how to reach this incentive or how to use the information in the posters in order to help us to actually do the job.
It was irritating. But at least having a CMMI standard process. What could managers do to improve things for the workers?
Additional learning.
More training?
I'm sorry, can you deliver 5 red beads continuously?
5 red beads?
Yes. Or less.
If I can do it?
Yes.
Yes, of course. It's all in the
show up.
We don't do it.
You can.
What could managers have done?
The manager
to improve the process.
The managers could have done the work?
Yes, in 3 shifts.
In 3 shifts, yes. I don't know if that would have helped.
Well, the planning would have helped if they would anticipate that the new team will actually not match up to their expectations, and there has to be a rather larger buffer zone in cases they actually do not do the good job you expect.
Okay, now that's one thing. Anything else?
Everything that you said as a manager was saying that you are a bad worker, and this influences a psychological environment. So you can feel all the time bad because you work, you try your hardest, but you're never going to deliver the best, the necessary result.
Yeah, but I agree. what could I have done to improve?
You could have reasoned the people.
I could have
fired the worker.
Yes. To listen to the workers.
I have some better developers. Oh, sorry, work.
You could take out the red beads and don't put them back.
I could take out the red beads. Yeah, what are the red beads in our company? If this was a software development project for real, what would
bugs
the red beads
be?
Sorry?
Some bugs, some errors.
Bugs, errors? Yeah.
Communication problem.
Communication problem.
Misaligned objectives.
Misaligned objectives.
Risks.
Risks. Yeah, and according to Deming, the red beads represent everything that's bad in a process. Faulty tool, a bad design, a defective part, procedural flaw, an unreasonable change request, stuff like that. Anything that can and do go wrong with the process. And Deming ran this experiment lots and lots and lots of times, and this is some of the most common learnings. It's the system, not the workers. Nothing we do can affect the result. It's only random. It's management thinking that designed the system, so management thinking should be able to change the system. And the arbitrary numerical targets were completely ineffective. Rewarding or punishing the workers had no effect. Rigid and precise procedures are not sufficient to produce quality. Keeping the best workers did not work. And management tampering creates more problems than it solves. And tampering is a word that Deming used a lot, and that's kind of like the things we do when we want to show that we actually do something about the problem. We explain, we do appraisals, and we talk, and we come in and, oh, this something has to be done here, and but we can't really affect it. Posters and slogans are best useless and can be insulting and create resentment. I think you felt that. And the biggest source of variation is in the system. So it was random. There's a certain amount of red beads, and it will be random how many you produce. Actually, not numerical randomness, but that's another concept. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about what happened here. It's called the theory of variation.
we assume that, that workers can be accountable, held accountable for the work they do, and that we can measure it. But this ignores the theory of variation. And that's what I'm going to talk about, and it's really simple stuff. The first principle of the theory of variation is that we should expect things to vary because they always do. Imagine that this is a graph of my performance, and you might like to think of yourselves as my manager. Okay. The top of the graph, that's the kind of performance you want from me, and then down at the bottom is the kind you don't want. If I perform like that today, what would you say?
Good work, right?
Yeah, great, good work. Joakim, great. So if I perform like that the next day, what would you say to me?
Is something wrong?
Something wrong, yeah. You're slipping. You could do better. Maybe you know you can do better. You did it last day. What about now?
It's a trend.
And in the old bad days, you would probably turn up and kick my ass. And at least let me know very clearly that I was doing something wrong. But now we send managers to coaching programs. So what do? You show up and you give me some therapy. Is everything okay, you with him? Are you happy? Is there something wrong with your dog? Or pet turtle? And my problem is that you show up at all, because it's variation. If I plot my performance over time, it varies. It has to. There's natural variation in everything, in any system. So we should expect things to vary, because they always do. We'll get back to that. And Deming showed using a very simple statistical formula that I won't go into in detail, but it's, you can look it up at the internet. But you can see whether this variation is predictable or unpredictable. These numbers between the upper control limit and the lower control limit, everything that's within these control limits is natural, expected, predictable variation. A number down here is as likely to appear as a number up here. It just varies. The second, I will get back to that as well. The second principle of the theory of variation is understanding variation will tell us what to expect. Let's take a scrum team as an example. This is their velocity, plotted over time, sprint by sprint. It goes up and it goes down. I don't know if your velocity ever does that, but it's common. After a few bad sprints, we get one good, and then it drops again, and so on. And then the manager suddenly takes an interest. There's something wrong with the animation, so you don't see this. Here the manager checks in and says, what's going wrong? What's so wrong? What's happening here? And he says, I know you can do better, because I've seen you do it. If you improve, I will give you a reward. That seems to be working. It seems to be working, right? That's good. What happens next? Whoops. The situation gets even worse. What happened? Well, nothing happened, because it varies. But the manager thinks, he repents. Why did I reward them? They became complacent. They're resting on their laurels. So the situation gets even worse, as you see. And he thinks, no more Mr. Nice Guy. He runs out of patience and he has a tantrum and he demands that you have to get your act together. Okay? Or there will be consequences.
And the game works.
And it rises. It seems to be working. Tough management works. And what he's actually doing is the same thing that I did, and that someone noticed, probably you noticed. I just explained the numbers as I wanted to. Yeah, the incentives work. You see? That's what they did. And of course, I couldn't know that before we did this experiment. But no matter what happens with the numbers, I can always come up with great explanations to what happens. But in reality, all the data points, all the values are within the statistical control limits. It's not natural variations. There are no signals in the data. But the managers as and also normal people have been trained to see trends and to compare values. Last quarter's result, this quarter's result. If you give a manager two data points, they can come up with all kinds of explanations as why they need. And not only can, but they'll offer explanations as soon as they see something. And I find that's a problem with many Scrum teams that, well, I get into this soon. This is the second principle of the theory of variation. Understanding variation will tell us what to expect. If nothing changes in the development organization, we can expect that the velocity is as low as 15 or as high as 40. But more often, the velocity will be around the mean, 26.75, in this case. This is what Deming called the voice of the process. This is the result that we get if we don't make changes to the process. But even if managers understand velocity, they typically act as they don't expect things to vary. That's why, okay, they hear 27 points average, so this is what will happen. But it isn't. And if it's not managers that do this, it's the Scrum team itself. I've seen this happen a lot of times. They beat themselves up for not meeting the commitment. We said 30 and we ended up with 27. What did we do wrong? We must get better at estimating, right? We must estimate better. Put some extra effort into the story points at the beginning of the sprint planning, then we will be on target. But after understanding variation, you realize that this isn't actually achievable. Work will vary, team performance will vary, unexpected issues, dependencies, blockers, etc. All of that stuff that happens that makes the velocity vary. Think of driving into work. I live in Stockholm, there's a lot of traffic. So when I drive into work, I know it's about 25 minutes. Some days, if I'm in a hurry, I'm late, it's 18 minutes. Another day, it's 20. 25, it's the traffic, the speed, the weather, everything. I have to stop to fill up gas, stuff like that. And we're humans, working with other humans in a team, with knowledge work. Of course, things will vary. It's not predictable. Variation will occur. Okay, so if this is my performance, and you want to motivate me and set a target, where do you put it?
Somewhere
yeah,
between average and lower control?
At the average, maybe?
A bit lower.
You're not ambitious enough.
Not ambitious enough?
No.
At lower control.
So if I set it here, on the average, what will happen is that one day I will go home happy, and the other I will go home unhappy. Because it will vary. So maybe put it there, a stretch goal, right?
Stretch.
That's very popular.
Then nobody goes home.
It's not achievable. No, then I
it's
go
not
home.
Achievable.
I go home unhappy every day.
But if you put the lower one, the
it's
human, good. When they achieve this, that they will stop and will not try to push harder.
Yeah. So why set it there? What's the point of setting it? Go there.
There is no point in setting a goal if the variation is inherent to the system.
There is no need to set a goal because the variation is inherent. But what happens actually when I put it, when I do a stretch goal, a lot of people will actually meet the goal. But at what cost? They will cheat to reach the goal. Maybe not consciously, but they will do things to reach the goal. Maybe for a sprint, what the Scrum team might have done when they got the reward in the earlier example is to actually push a lot of defects into the next sprint. Kind of do crappy code now and pay for it later. That's a way to reach the target. But managers set targets or standards and react to people's failure to meet them. And when we understand variation, we understand that targets don't work. They don't motivate people, but they can demotivate people. This is a true Cutter is a big consultancy in the US. This is a senior consultant who said, I recently asked a colleague, a CIO, whether he would prefer to deliver a project somewhat late and over budget, rich in business benefits, or one that is on time and under budget, but of scant value to the business. he thought it was a tough call. And then he went for the on-time scenario. Delivering on time and within budget is part of his IT department's performance metrics. Chasing after the elusive business value, over which he thought he had little control anyway, is not. There's an article in the Harvard Business Review, the one most requested. It's Frederick Hertzberg, One More Time, How Do You Motivate Employees? Is the name of the article. And his answer is, you can't. You can't motivate people. I don't know if you've read the really good book by Dan Pink, that's called Drive, The Surprising Truth About What Really Motivates Us. It's basically, people want to be autonomous, to choose what they work with, who they work with, when they work. They want mastery, to be able to improve and get challenging tasks. And they want purpose, to be part of something bigger, something important. But that's tricky for a manager to just hand out when the deadline is not met. Deming said that if you give a manager a numerical target, he'll make it, even if he has to destroy the company in the process. And that's, of course, the danger with setting targets. So the third principle of the theory of variation is work on the causes of variation, which are always found in the system. The majority of performance is down to the system, Deming found. A bad system will defeat a good person every time. And the majority of possibilities for improvement are in the system. Is at 95% and 5% with the individual. Don't get too hung up on the numbers. It's more like the proportions. So examples of system conditions, or red beads, if you will, that affect our performance are kind of like work design, policies, measures, structure, roles, procedures, information, job skills, knowledge, business cases, funding, board requirements, inspection, compliance. Usually things that come upstream, like the red beads, the material that was handed to us. Maybe we could have a better material, better things upstream, better requirements, for example, if you're a development team. Work design is a typical thing that management can do a lot about. One of the advantages with Scrum is the possibility to really work as a team, teamwork. But if the managers and the product owner design the work, like fill the backlog with small tasks, one suited for a web developer, another for a backend developer, and so on, they won't teamwork. They will not work together as a team. That's just one example of to think about work design. So the causes of variation identified within the team's control are acted on by the team. And those beyond the team are acted on by the manager. And they don't just remove impediments, they actively work on improving the system. The job of management should change to be a cooperative role, working on the system, fixing things outside the workers' control, experimenting alongside the staff, and working with experimenting with work methods, and ensure that the system gets better every day. The fourth principle of the theory of variation is understanding variation tells you when something has happened. As we have seen, a statistical process control helps differentiate signals from noise. So we look to understand and reduce the extent of common cause variation, the system conditions I talked about. But sometimes we see special causes, like this, points outside of the natural variation. And the problem with the Red Bead experiment is, as a manager, I acted as if everything was a special cause variation. But it wasn't, it was a common cause variation. So for example, if think of me driving to work again, and I get a flat tire, and it suddenly takes 60 minutes, that's a special cause. Should I change anything in how I drive in order to make it to work in the coming weeks? No, probably not. If it's not super important for me to never have a flat tire, then maybe I should have a Vespa in the luggage and just park the car and drive if I get a flat tire. Or if these bikes keep going, I have 3 flat tires in 4 weeks, then maybe something is wrong with how I drive or the road or the tires or something. So that's a signal to actually investigate if it's something you want to do something with. So I won't go much into this numbers exercise, because I don't think it's it can be useful to measure stuff like that and put things in a statistical process chart, but that's not the main point here. It's understanding these things and the theory of variation that takes you a long way, not the actual statistics or numbers. So I'm going to end there because the time is running out of time. So thank you for listening.